studio in Massapequa, Long Island. It's the Buzz Talk Live Show.
Thank you for joining me tonight on this Sunday evening. And, you know, I just need you to grow this channel and make sure that you, you smash that like and subscribe button. It's been a little hairy here in the studio. But you know, I need to grow this channel to about 1,000 views at this point, and I want to make sure that we get there. And also during the program, make sure to use your chat function. So I'm really excited for tonight's guest. He's a major vocalist. He's a world-renowned vocalist, an Emmy Award-winning actor, and a Broadway performer, better known as his starring role as playing Emilio Estefan in the hit Broadway musical On Your Feet. He's also performing live at 54 Below in New York City. So please welcome Mauricio Martinez to Buzz Talk Live. Mauricio, how are you, my friend? All right. How you been? All right?
I'm good. Very excited to be connected.
Awesome. You know, I tell you, the last time we worked together, actually, was a few months ago in Bryant Park, in Manhattan. You know, New York City does this tree lighting every year. And that's the first time I met you there. And it was about 2 years ago, I want to say, that we met each other. And I direct the RoboCams for that event. And as that event was going on, you're co-hosting. I forget the woman that co-hosted with you.
Yeah, this year I co-hosted with Jen Colella.
I'm sitting backstage. I'm directing these cameras, and I'm like, oh my God, this guy's voice is incredible. And you blew me away, man. And I can really appreciate talent when I see it. And I said to myself, my God, I got to have this guy on Buzz Talk Live. And here you are. Amazing, man. Thank you so much for having me. Yeah, no, and thank you for taking the invitation up, man. It's awesome that you're doing this. We have a little clip here. I know it's not Christmas time, but we do have a little clip here just to kind of whet the appetite of our viewers of your incredible talent. So let's play clip number one.
Silent night, holy night. All is calm, all is bright, round the young virgin, mother and child. So tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly que esparcen su luz, vienen a ver al niñito Jesús. Brilla la estrella de paz, brilla la estrella
amazing. Simply amazing. And you know what's really cool was that it was like 28 degrees out there that night.
Yes, it was.
And so you got to tell me, I mean, first of all, the mixture of English and Spanish and pulling that off, well, for me, I don't speak Spanish, but it's incredible what you did. And you're so talented. But singing in the cold weather like that, I mean, I know myself, like, sometimes I can't even talk in the cold weather, let alone sing. Right. How does, you know, talk to me about that a little bit. Like, when you're preparing to sing in a cold weather, I saw you backstage and you weren't really doing much. I mean, you're such a pro. You just go out there and you do it. Well, talk to us a little bit about that.
I mean, when you've doing this for a while, you get used to it. You know, you warm up and you're ready to go.
Right.
And living in a city like New York, you know, in the wintertime, it's cold. And sometimes you get hired to sing outside in the cold. You gotta be extra careful, take lots of vitamin C, and be very well covered, like, because it's cold,
sure.
It's freezing. It was 28 degrees, definitely.
Sure, sure.
We were hanging backstage, and I just came out for my intervention, and then came back in, and then again, like, back and forth. You have to do it that way. But I was wearing thermal underwear. That's my secret.
Oh, gee, no, I didn't wear thermal underwear.
Well, so you were not singing.
I was not singing, that's right. So there you go. There's a trick of the trade. Amazing. Yeah. And, you know, and we're going to do that again, you know, this coming fall. I can't wait. Hopefully you'll be joining us again for that
hopefully.
Event.
I mean, it's the second year in a row that I've done it. And hopefully I'll do it again. I'd be honored.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
Great.
No, it's always a treat. It's always a treat listening to you. It's always a treat listening to you. So talk to me. So you're of Mexican descent. You're born and raised in Mexico. And so you hit the States. And talk to me about growing up in Mexico and your family life. And was there a parent that had a voice? Was music in your house? Was, you know, talk to me about that.
Not really. As far as I'm concerned, I'm the only singer. Or even actor.
Really?
My mom really has a lot to do with it because she used to play movies, musical Hollywood movies for me when I was a kid, like Grease and Singing in the Rain and Sound of Music and Hello Dolly. I remember watching all the movies and I was just electrified, you know, watching John Travolta in Grease. I wanted to be like him. And then as time went by, I started putting the pieces together and realized that most of those movies came from a stage version, and that stage version was in a place called Broadway, and that Broadway was New York.
Oh.
So that's when I realized that I had to be in New York, and the rest is history.
So as far as Mexico, though, you were performing in Mexico at some low-level stage presentations, performance?
Yes. I had a big television career over there, and I did lots of telenovelas, which it's basically Spanish soap operas.
Right, right.
And I recorded a couple of albums, did tours, a couple of films, but lots and lots of theater, musical theater. I starred in Jesus Christ Superstar, Saturday Night Fever, Beauty and the Beast, Sweet Charity. The list is long, but I always had the dream of coming back to New York and being on Broadway.
Yeah.
So that didn't happen until 2017.
And as far as like developing your style, your ear for music, and I mean that's a talent into itself, because you're such a, you know, comfortable performer on stage, and you're such a showman when you're performing. And we'll have a couple of clips here to show that off. But you know, developing your voice as a young performer. I mean, when did you find out that, you know, you could pull this off?
Well, I mean, I always knew I had a voice ever since I could remember. I would open my mouth and like sound would come out and I would be on pitch. I started mimicking other singers.
Oh, okay.
First in television.
Okay.
Like Michael Jackson, you know. Little by little, it wasn't until I was in my teenage years that I realized that you could study voice lessons. It could actually take singing lessons.
Right, right.
And I started taking singing lessons when I was between 15 and 16, you know, being a man. Go through that change of voice. So you really can't take voice lessons around 13, 14, because you're basically cracking all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, I discovered that. I had a great voice teacher, and I just fell in love with discovering new techniques, breathing and support.
Sure,
and
sure.
Singing is very visual, you know, and I think as artists, we tend to daydream a lot or picture things all the time. So
yeah.
That definitely helps with the imagery, you know,
absolutely.
Thinking about when you feel your lungs and your support, breath support,
yeah.
Making the note. But yeah, that's how I fell in love with singing.
Wow.
And
that
I had a really
it's
good a,
it's definitely.
And then I started acting and then
yeah.
I started dancing. And it just like snowballed from there.
Well, you're blessed with a voice, and you're blessed with your capabilities of performing on stage for sure. So you moved to New York City, and you got the taste of New York City right away, didn't you?
Yeah. Oh, yes.
Tell us the story about the subway there, Mauricio.
Oh, yeah. Well, I came to study to a school called AMDA, the American Musical and Dramatic Academy.
Yeah.
1998. I first came to audition in 1997. I was 18 years old. I was accepted with a scholarship to come to New York, started performing arts, the conservatory. So I moved here, and I was here pretty much all of 98, 99. But when I graduated, I started auditioning for Broadway shows. And that subway story is actually one of my first ever auditions for a Broadway show. Little did I know that one of my favorite movies of all time, which is Saturday Night Fever, was going to be turned into a musical. First, they put it up in the West End. So I went to the open call, but of course it was a dance call first, and it was rush hour, and I was on the subway. And as soon as I hit the station, I was about to leave, and somebody pushed me off the subway.
Oh boy!
So I twisted my ankle, and I hurt it. So of course, when I finally got to the audition, it was a dance call first. So you can imagine how that went.
Oh yeah,
it was
geez.
Sad as I was cut. So I was going back home on the subway, depressed.
No doubt.
I said, Saturday Fever for me. But then 2 years later, I want to say, I was singing for a cruise line, part of as a guest entertainer in the cast of the shows on board, a very popular cruise line. And the director on board was that same lady, choreographer from Britain.
Oh, wow.
That cut me.
Oh, wow.
Of course, I never told her anything. And one day we were having dinner after we had worked already together. And she said, you know what, Mauricio, I've been watching you, and you'd be a great Tony Manero.
You'd be
and
a
I
what?
Said,
what did you say?
I told her, well, I auditioned for Broadway and you cut me. Of course, she didn't remember.
Okay.
But she said, you know what, we're doing it in Germany. Would be interested in auditioning.
Mm-hmm.
So I said yes, and I got off the ship for a week. And I came to New York and I auditioned. Made it to final file callbacks, and then I was offered to be the understudy. But when I called my mother, tell her the news, told me that my dad had just been diagnosed with cancer, terminal.
Oh, wow.
Prostate cancer. So it had been like already 4 years since I had left. So I didn't do the show, obviously. I dropped everything and I went back to Mexico. My father died, and then a year later, I'm in Mexico City. And I was participating in basically the Mexican version of American Idol.
Okay.
2002. And when the show was done, the very next day I get a phone call from one of the producers. And he says, Mao, I have this theater producer here. And he's been seeing you, watching you on the show. And he really likes what you do. And he thinks you're perfect for this leading role of this West End musical that he bought the rights of. And they've been rehearsing. But they need to open in like 3 weeks. But he said that he would love for you to come in and try out for the part. And I said, "What show is this?" And he said, "Saturday Night Fever."
Oh, geez.
So of course, I went in and I auditioned, and I
wow.
got the role. That was
wow.
my first starring role
wow.
in New York City, with some fame right after the TV show. And it was a great success. I did the show for almost a year, and we.
Yeah.
Won all the awards. It was a great time in my life. It was 21 years ago.
Wow. That's amazing. I mean, the irony of that, because as a boy, you know, you looked up to, you know, Saturday Night Fever and John Travolta and acting and singing and all that. And then lo and behold, years later, you got the role.
I got the role. Be careful what you wish for.
Yeah. I don't know.
I have a couple of stories like that.
I've been wishing to hit the lottery, but it's you know, it's not happening.
Yeah, exactly.
So You know, and I wanted to kind of dive into this because, you know, it's a touchy subject, but also, you know, you're an advocate of mental health, and it's important for you because you've been battling, or you went through, you're a survivor, a four-time cancer survivor, yeah. Aren't you?
That is right.
And as far as, you know, family support and your faith and you're now taking the torch and advocating for other people who is going through the same thing you're going through or you did.
Yeah, I mean, I'm a four-time cancer survivor. And I know what that word represents for so many people. So I think I tried at least to use my platform I've gained over the years, thanks to my work,
yeah,
to inspire people, you know, and to let them know that it's okay to feel down, and it's okay to want to throw the towel every now and then. But as long as you permit, allow yourself to be vulnerable, but fighting. You know, I'm a living proof that you can survive, that you can fight, and I'm living the life of my dreams. It hasn't been easy. It still isn't easy. But what is easy? You know, I think it would be so boring if.
Absolutely.
If it was easy.
Yeah.
Yes, I am a four-time cancer survivor. I'm an advocate for early detection. And I think cancer diagnosis goes hand in hand with mental health. I think we're, especially in countries like mine, you know, Mexico, Latin America, we're not used to talking about mental health as much as we are used to talking about it here. You know, in the States, I think it's pretty normalized to talk about it. But in Mexico, I remember it's a macho country. You know?
Yeah.
Being a man, you don't talk about your emotions.
Right.
Men
right.
Don't cry.
Right.
Nobody goes to therapy. So you gotta fight that stigma. So I've been very blessed to be here.
Yeah.
And I'm very vocal about it because I always believe that there's somebody watching that might be touched, that might be inspired.
Absolutely.
Inspire somebody to keep fighting, to not give up. Then you've done something good with it.
Well,
it's not all like glamour.
Well, God bless you, my friend. That was something that you went through in life, and that's all behind you now. You know, I tell you, you've taken the role as Emilio Estefan, and that was a starring role for you on Broadway. Amazing, and you know. Gloria, that music in the 90s and when she was hot and heavy there, that was like, you know, that was the thing, man. I mean, everybody was tuning into that stuff, and that was the sound of the 90s, you know, the Miami sound machine, and Emilio was such a big part of that and her success too. And then you're playing him. That's incredible. You know, that must have been a dream for you.
It was a dream. I think it was the marriage of both of my worlds, you know, my Latino music world, my heritage, my upbringing. Of course, I grew up admiring Gloria very much because I remember she was one of the few, her and Julio Iglesias, artists that recorded the same songs in both English and Spanish. And that's how I grew up. You know,
I'm
more than bilingual. I consider myself to be bicultural in a way, you know, because I grew up in Mexico, but I grew up also very Americanized. Monterrey, the city where I'm from, is very American. So I grew up listening to Mexican music and watching telenovelas and all that. But I was also glued to Hollywood and American music. And I remember watching Gloria's music videos. And I was just a huge fan. Little did I know that years later I would meet her in New York and be auditioning to play her husband, you know, who is by far, you know, a legend, an icon, somebody that's loved and so respected, not only in the music world, but in the world, you know. I am blessed to call them friends today.
Yeah.
They're the sweetest, the most humble. They've become family mentors.
Oh, wow.
And it was an honor of my life. Emilio tell both their story.
Yeah, sure.
When I said it was a marriage among both worlds, I mean, yes, the Latin culture, but also Broadway that I had ever remember, you know? I couldn't have had a better show to make my Broadway debut with.
Wow.
Because this was actually my culture, my people. On Your Feet became the first show in Broadway history to have 99% of all Latino performers on stage. There was only one American-born, not Hispanic, not Latino actor.
Right.
The rest of us were all Latino. So, I mean, that's huge. Very inspiring.
That show went on for how long did that show last? And then it went on tour, and then you took it on tour, right? Didn't you?
Yes, I took the tour. I was the last Nino on Broadway. I was the third actor to portray Nino on Broadway, and then I took the show on the road for a little bit over a year. You know, playing in cities like, I mean, Washington, the Kennedy Center, the Pantages Theater in Los Angeles.
Right.
We went to San Francisco, to San Antonio, to Dallas, to Boston.
Wow.
You name it, we were there. You know?
Yeah.
And it was great. It was a great way to get to know the country. And of course, while I did it, I was going through my own immigration process, getting my green card. So the story was pretty much my story. Every night I was telling my story. You know, there was a very moving scene in On Your Feet when Gloria and me come to New York to what is,
that must have been
now,
unreal.
Sony
yeah.
Broadway.
Yeah,
when they wanted to cross over and record in English.
Right.
They were already huge in the Hispanic market, in the Latin market in Spanish. And they start playing a demo of Gloria singing in English, and the A&R stops it and says, nope, you're never going to cross over. You're too Latin. Or if you want to do that, move the horns, change your last name. And that's when Emilio gets up and starts saying this beautiful monologue. That starts basically saying, change my name. It's not my name. It's my father's name, my grandfather's name.
Right, right.
From Cuba. And it basically became a roller coaster. And at the very end, I would say, take a good look at my face. This is what an American looks like. And the response that we got from the audience night after night was electrifying. You know,
really?
You can imagine being a Mexican immigrant going through his own immigration process while performing and saying those lines night after night, it really hit home in more ways than one.
Sure.
So it was a beautiful experience. And I look back at it with lots of gratitude. And I know I was very blessed to play such an important, beautiful human being like me.
Oh, absolutely. And continued friendship, you know, through these years with the family and with Gloria. So for a person that's, you know, starting out or actually has been on Broadway and performing, what advice would you give, you know, aspiring performers and people that in your world, you know?
These are very interesting times we're living. You know, when I grew up, and I was studying to become a performer.
Right.
We had no internet. We had no social media. There was no YouTube, TikTok, no Instagram, no nothing. Mm-hmm. So we, in a way, I think we were more free because we weren't glued to competition or to constantly be compared to other people. Mm-hmm. So my advice to kids nowadays would disconnect yourself a little bit from technology
and
focus on yourself as an artist. Really focus on what makes you happy, what makes you vibe, what makes your heart tremble. You know, what do you want to become? Do you want to be famous or do you want to transcend? You want credibility,
speech,
or just fame? I think people nowadays expect everything to be so fast. And life is not like that. This industry is not like that. So I would say study hard, be humble, try not to burn bridges, be disciplined, be on time, know your lines, and be ready because when opportunity comes, you better be ready.
Absolutely.
Behind you, there's so many other people wanting to be in that position. So take it seriously.
You know, in my business, you're as good as your last show.
Exactly.
You know, so you've done some other classic Man of La Mancha. I want to talk. I have a clip of that you playing Don Quixote. That's incredible. I mean, that's a classic play and performance that you did. I want to show a clip of you singing in the whole garb and everything. You were dressed yes. up and awesome. Let's show that clip. Incredible, man. I mean, just the power of your performance too. I mean, you get the crowd into it. Like I said, you're such a showman. So talk to me about a lot of these performances that you, because you were also in Beauty and the Beast, right? You did Beauty
yes,
and the Beast.
I played the Beast.
You
Mexico
played the
City
Beast. So as a performer, as a singer, and as a world-class vocalist like yourself, you have all this apparatus, you have the makeup, you have, you know, the prosthetics on your face and stuff like that. Yeah. Does that, is that a challenge for you to sing?
Yeah, sometimes it's, back in the day, I did Beauty and the Beast in 2007 to 2008.
That was
a while ago. But yeah, that design of the makeup and the prosthetics and the hair.
Right.
Everything is hard. It's a very challenging role. I think it's one of the most, if not the most challenging physically. I think it's right up there with Don Quixote, but of course I was younger. I did this piece. With Don Quixote, there isn't a lot of prosthetics really. In this version, it took place in a modern day detention center. So Cervantes literally turns from into Quixote right in front of the audience's eyes, you know.
Right.
I literally would grab a little box and like start putting on makeup as I was singing sing the big opening song,
you know,
I Don Quixote. But yeah, I mean, you have the wig, you have the mustache, but you get used to it, you know.
Yeah.
It's part of the magic, and that's the beauty of theater, you know. You're not yourself. It's very different than when I do concerts it is me.
Yeah.
Singing.
Yeah.
When it's the show, I'm the character. You know?
Right.
So I think we're basically vehicles, you know, whatever.
Absolutely.
Author wants you to do, and you're like a vessel in a way.
Yeah.
So, but it's, some are more challenging than others. Emilio was very comfortable.
Right.
Because he had no prosthetic.
Right.
I wore a few pair of, a pair of jeans, a pair of white, black, pants and white shorts.
Easy peasy.
And that was it. It was very, very easy as far as costumes.
Yeah. So going forward with your quest in your Broadway performances, do you have any dream roles that you're looking at, or do you want to become? Or, I mean.
Well, yeah. I mean, there are a few. I just actually released an album that talks about
We're going to talk about that. Yeah.
Most of the dream roles that I have. There's one in particular that more than my dream role, it's my mother's dream role for me.
Oh.
And that's Phantom of the Opera.
Oh, yeah.
But of course, not close on Broadway. So
yeah, I know.
May have to
I
go
know.
To Spain or London.
Yeah. And you would be great in that. I've seen that a couple of times, actually.
I love that show. I think
yeah, it is a great show.
It's a great four.
Yep.
I think I'm in the right age.
Yep.
There's other roles that I would love. I would love to play Billy Flynn in Chicago. I think that's fun.
Mm.
King George in Hamilton. I think it would be an important statement.
Yeah, yeah.
To be a Mexican playing that role. It's fun and witty. And that's always fun.
Yeah.
But I also believe in originating roles, you know, mm-hmm. roles that nobody else has ever played. You know, that is my dream. I mm-hmm. have in a couple of weeks the world premiere recording of a musical that is West End bound, and I recorded the vocals mm-hmm. for the lead.
Oh.
And it's called Figaro.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a brand new role. Nobody has ever done it.
Oh, wow. That's a challenge.
And it was sort of tailored to my voice because the composer
right.
saw me in On Your Feet a couple of years ago, and she started following me on social media, and she started like listening to my album, watching videos and concerts from me, and then basically tailored. This is something she confessed later on. He tailored the role of the girl with my voice to my voice. So I'm very flattered. And
yeah.
Of course, when the director, Lolo Ciara, who's a dear friend of mine, reached out last year and said, how would you be interested in recording this world premiere recording of this musical that we want to take to the West End called Figaro? It takes place in the 1800s, and it's a love story. And it's very similar, in a way, to Phantom of the Opera and Moulin Rouge. So that's what excites me the most, you know?
It's a challenge.
Originate
yeah.
a role
yeah.
and be the first actor ever to give voice
yeah.
to a role.
Sure. So I want to, we'll talk about the live album, but this is part of it. And because it's part of it, you've been associated with 54 Below. It's a supper club in Manhattan, New York.
Yeah.
It's a very unique space because there's people eating and people singing, you.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's, I've worked at the Rainbow Room years ago. I don't know if you've heard of that place, but they don't even have that cabaret there anymore.
Right.
But I've seen, like, you know, Rosemary Clooney there when she was alive. Wow. I've seen Tony Danza perform there. And it was a setup just like 54 Below. You know, it was a supper right. club, very intimate setting. And it reminds me of that. And so you're performing there, but that was that a spinoff of I have 5'11", and that's a COVID term or something, right? Talk to us about
that. No. 5'11", based in New York is the title of my show.
Oh, your title
that
show.
I started doing last year.
Okay,
and it's called a slate when actors. When you have to say basically before you audition.
Oh, audition.
You have
okay.
to say your name, your height, and where you're based. So I am Mauricio Martinez, 5'11", and I'm based in New York. That's why the title of the show.
Oh, the 5'11", that's clever. Very
and,
nice.
It's all basically self-tapes. You know, ever since the pandemic,
right?
We as actors have been asked
yeah.
to put ourselves on tape. And here, the living room of your place, you know, and you become your own director,
sure.
your own reader, your own makeup
sure.
artist, your own hairstylist.
Yeah. Yep.
You got to do it all.
It changed the world. It really has changed the world. The pandemic,
the world.
You know, with
yeah.
the whole Zoom, like, I mean, look what we're doing right here.
Yeah.
You know, and as far as actors, you know, at that time when there was no work, Broadway was shut down. And, you know, as far as, you know, you had still audition for the future roles, and you had to be your own producer, like you said, you know, your own camera person.
Yeah.
You got to set it all up and have it and do it. So
that was the premise of the show that then
right.
we turn into the album, you know, but the album is called Live in NYC because
right.
I have a very big following in Latin America and Mexico. And so they were not going to get 5'11" based in New York. That's very niche of New York.
So your live album,
yes,
your live album, and it dropped on February 4th. of this year. It's a great album. I was listening to it on Apple Music. And it's like 20 plus songs. Mauricio, what the hell did you do? It's like you got a whole menu of songs there. It's great.
You have a whole menu.
Yeah. And what I want to talk about is that you had a special guest. And her name, I'm going to mess up her name. It's Lynetta. Lynetta, you know. So she was part of your act or your performance, right? At 54 Below, and you recorded her on the live album. She's part of it.
Lynetta and I met on Your Feet,
right?
Back in 2017, when I joined the cast on Broadway, she played Gloria Estefan's sister and was the first understudy for Gloria. She went on to star in it in a production of Paper Mill Playhouse, I believe. And then but she made history last year when she became the first Latina actress ever to originate a role in an Andrew Lloyd Webber show.
Oh, wow.
Who I've also worked with in his autobiography called Show Unmasked. So when I asked her to be part of my show, she said yes, which was a true honor.
Yeah.
And we do a Latin medley of the best. The best Hispanic Broadway roles out there. So I needed a reader because they're all basically auditions.
Yeah.
So she does my Evita, my Che.
Nice.
And she also plays the Sancho to my Quixote, you know? So
Awesome.
It was a lot of fun. And now, of course, we recorded for posterity, and I couldn't be happier to have her as part of one of my guests.
Yeah. So when I was listening, one of the cuts, you tell a story of Stephen Sondheim. You reference a story about talk to me about that. About a callback.
I was very close to booking a company on Broadway. So little did I know that I was going to be singing, and that my audition was going to be seen by Stephen Sondheim. You know. Mm. Who, of course, sadly, unfortunately, passed a couple years ago. I mean, talk about a legend. Talk about somebody iconic, somebody respected. And I do a song that I auditioned with, you know, for this gender-twisted or bent production that they did on Broadway a couple years ago. I auditioned with the classic Another 100 People, you know, which defines what New York is like, you know. So yeah, I talk about that, and I talk about other stories.
Yeah.
I also do another Sondheim. I do two Sondheim numbers. I do one that's beautiful from Merrily We Roll Along, and it is called Good Thing Going, and it's a beautiful, heartbreaking ballad about a friendship that parted ways, you know, that obviously I can also relate. So yeah, I just loved how he
My god, Stephen Sondheim, I mean, he passed in 21, but he was 91, man. I couldn't believe that when I saw
I had the honor of singing for him at the gala and meeting him and at Lincoln Center a couple years ago, and so it was an honor of my life.
Yeah, absolutely. Moving on, so you just came back from Mexico, you know, and you were celebrating a 35-year-old musical there.
Yes.
I have a video I want to show.
An original
set it up.
Musical
that
turned 35 years, and we did a concert. They asked me to come close the show. And basically Mexico's most prestigious, it's like Mexico... Madison Square Garden, basically, and it's called El Auditorio Nacional, Mexico City.
Oh, okay.
And it was amazing to be back in Mexico for only a couple of days.
Wow.
I did a lot of press, obviously, promoting the album.
Sure.
But it was great. It was great to be back there for a little bit and see friends and connect again and perform again for a Mexican audience that hasn't really seen me in over 7 years.
Wow.
Ever since I moved to America. You know? Well, and now I'm in talks of returning soon. Doing my Below show over there.
Oh, that's nice.
So yeah,
That'll be cool, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. We do have a clip of you singing in Mexico. Let's run that.
Okay.
Okay.
You just jump on a plane, you fly to Mexico, and you give a performance like that. I mean, rehearsals, or, you know, you just went out cold?
You only had one rehearsal. You know, I practiced it here basically by myself, and I arrived to soundcheck, and did the show. That's how my life is.
You're
starting a workshop tomorrow for a new Broadway bound musical with Susan Stroman.
Oh, wow.
And I'm doing it for 5 days. We're doing the presentation on Friday, and then Saturday morning,
cool,
I fly early in the morning at 6 a.m. I fly to Florida to perform at the annual gala for Oslo Theater, where I performed Don Quixote last year.
We can't nail you down, Mauricio.
that's the artist's life. We're always in the play.
Absolutely right. So before I forget, Emmy Award. So you were on a show. It was Mexican, out of Mexico, El Vato, and you're always playing the bad guy.
Yes, in my television career in Mexico, I pretty much played the bad guy all the time.
Yeah.
Almost most of the time. And
that's cool.
It was a great show produced by NBC Universo. And we won the Emmy back in 2018.
Right.
2019. We won the Emmy as best non-English primetime TV show. So it was the honor.
A
great honor.
Yeah. And
the five leads, we get the Emmy.
Right.
So, cool. That made me an Emmy winner, and I'm so proud of that show. We had two seasons, and so, I always look back.
So let me ask you.
Smile on my face.
Yeah, absolutely. Let me ask you, because you're a stage performer, and you also were involved in the TV end or the film end of the world. Give me like the differences or challenges or the distinction, I should say, of working a live performance, like where you have to be on, you have to get it right, And with film, there's takes.
Yeah.
There's differences there.
I mean, there are differences. At the end of the day, you're still yourself, and you're performing, and you got to be ready.
Right.
Hopefully get it ready by the first take.
Absolutely.
You do have that.
Got that flexibility, cushion, right?
I say, like,
exactly.
If anything goes wrong, you can do another take. The same goes with an album when it's a live album. I've been blessed to record two studio albums, and you do a couple of versions, and then you decide which one is better.
Mm-hmm.
I'm usually not a singer that likes to cut and paste. I know others do. I'm a huge Barbra Streisand fan, so I learned from the best.
Well, she's got
a
voice.
I'm a kind of guy. And that comes from theater.
Yes.
Theater and live performance gives you that.
Absolutely.
Rigor, that discipline. You have to be ready.
Mm-hmm.
And like you saw it, for the Bryant Park Christmas tree lighting, you get one chance.
That's it.
And that's it.
That's it. You got one shot.
So I'm used to that. That's where I'm the most comfortable live performing.
Yeah.
Both theater and concerts. But yeah, the end result of a film or a TV show is always nice.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, the paycheck is also nice.
Yeah.
But yeah, there are definitely differences.
Well, I think
theater is bigger.
Right.
And
when
you're acting to a camera, everything's smaller.
Right.
In a way, everything's in your eyes.
Right.
And, so there are some differences, but ultimately, you can be connected to your other partners. And make the audience feel whatever the author and the director wants them to feel. Whether it's a 3,000 theater, 3,000 seat theater, or a movie, or something in your iPhone. We're so used to these nowadays.
Yep.
I've been blessed to navigate various media, but I do have to say my favorite is definitely the live.
It's the live.
Yeah. There's nothing like doing it live.
Oh no! I mean, you got the whole adrenaline and then you back it up with that incredible voice of yours. So, where can people find you? How can they follow you? Give me all your social too.
Well, I'm on all social media networks. I'm on, it's Twitter, but Now it's X, I guess.
X, yeah.
I call it Twitter.
I call it Twitter.
And Facebook.
Yeah.
And Instagram. I'm at Martinez Mao, Mauricio Martinez. I just got TikTok recently. I'm not really a huge TikTok guy, but you got to go with your time. I do have TikTok. But yeah, I'm big on Instagram and Twitter and Facebook. So, and right. Of course, my music is in all music platforms.
Yeah, yeah.
iTunes, Spotify, mm-hmm. Apple Music, YouTube, you name it, we're there. I have 3 albums out. The 2 first albums are in Spanish, Latin pop, and the studio albums. And the 3rd album that just came out, Third Child, is Live at NYC. And it is was recorded live from below. And it is my first ever live album. And it's the best of Broadway recorded on Broadway.
Wow. Yeah. That's awesome. Mauricio, it was such a pleasure talking to you and having
Likewise.
You on Buzz Talk Live. You know, you're an incredible talent, and I wish you all the best of luck and continued success in Broadway and your
Thank
album,
you.
Your releases, and oh my God, you look at you. You're something else.
Thank
amazing.
You so much. This means a lot to me.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Stay right there. My God, this has been an incredible show tonight. I want to thank Mauricio again for tuning in with me and chatting about his incredible career. And I just want to give a shout out to Janet Lopez. Janet, if you're out there, hey, how you doing? And I'm glad that you tuned in. And I'm glad everybody tuned in to the Buzz Talk Live show. And we're hoping to maybe have this format again and live in audience and personal touches around the stage here at the beautiful Paradise Studios in Massapequa. But that's it for tonight, folks. I want to thank you again and thank Mauricio. And good night, America.